some restoration. So as we can see now, the Alawai ecosystem is not in a healthy state. We also had to touch flood mitigation because there is this 100-year flood that is, there are some scientific probability that it's going to happen in 100 years, and it would devastate Waikiki. So we had to come up with a plan to solve that. We also needed to figure out how to engage the community and bring in cultural connections, so tying it back to the Hawaiian heritage. There is also community access, so bringing people to the Alawai so that they could see the conditions and want to help, and economic health and resiliency. So we had to make sure that our project brought in profit and was economically feasible. Okay, so, and these were just some technological things. Our submission requirements, so we registered January between 9th and 31st of 2017, and the project was due in March. Winners were announced June 17th at the World Youth Congress, and our project, our overall submission had to include a project narrative, which was basically an essay highlighting our solutions, a design board, which I think is coming up in the next slides, and these presentation slides.
Okay, so our approach to getting through this project was, first we wanted to figure out what the problems are at the Alawai, so like researching what a dead zone is, what causes that, and then once we understood the risk that a 100-year flood causes on Waikiki, the poor conditions of the Alawai Canal, all that, then we started to brainstorm ideas on how to resolve this. And so we went about this by just taking a bunch of post-it notes and writing down any ideas we had, including things that made sense, but we didn't limit ourselves. So any ideas, as wild as it may be, we wrote it down, and some of those ended up on this project. And then, so once we got our ideas together, we determined the feasibility of these ideas, calculating the costs and how possible it would be to implement it in Hawaii. And then finally, we organized this together into a cohesive project, putting together the five pillars that we just explained into three steps, which is basically funding our project, and taking action, and then finally engaging the community so that they're aware of the problems. So this is our design board. We decided to, or we had several ideas that we located them on where they would improve the Alawai watershed. So the Alawai watershed is this 19 square mile area of Oahu and Honolulu. And so we wanted to make sure that we implemented ideas and solutions that would improve up to the top of the streams and all the way down to Waikiki. So, and then finally, we had to show how our ideas would be implemented and improve the systems in this watershed over time. And so on the right, we have our early action identification timeline. So that just shows things that we hope will have a positive effect after 1 month, such as making money for the further actions we take, and then all the way to long-term solutions that will prevent further problems.
So the first problem that we wanted to address was funding and how we could make money for our project. And we thought that maybe we could create a farmer's market along the Alawai Promenade, which is a really ideal location because it's right on Alawai, and it's, as you can see in that picture on the right, my right, it's like a wide open sidewalk where vendors can station themselves and sell their goods, and people can walk through and then buy goods from local farmers or businesses. And we could possibly have this farmer's market maybe twice a week. And then to generate money for our project, we could either take a certain amount of their profits that they made, or we could either charge them a certain fee to sell their goods on the Olawai Promenade. And another way that we wanted to address funding was to create a recreational fishing, business, where we have tourists or locals around the area who are interested to come and fish the invasive species out. And this not only benefits, it not only makes money for us, but it also takes out the invasive species that are still in the Olawai. And to make money out of this, we can give people 25 cents per pound of fish that they fish out. So it's like an incentive for them to come and take out invasive species. And with those invasive species that people take out, we can turn that into fertilizer to help grow a kulikuli, which is a plant that can be used for bioremediation.
That'll be explained later. So moving on to our action plans. So dissolved oxygen is one of the most critical indicators of a water body's health. And the Olawai Canal has really low dissolved oxygen levels. And we discovered this technology called water aeration technology that would offer several solutions to this and benefits for the ecosystem's health. So it's basically an aerator. So it would be put at the bottom of the canal and it would filter the water and naturally reduce algae by doing this, reduce the carbon dioxide content and hopefully push out the phosphorus and nitrogen levels in the water without adding any harmful chemicals. And this water aeration will also push out some of the sludge and nutrients that's at the bottom of the canal that's taking up a lot of the area of the water. And another positive effect of this would be that it naturally reduces all these chemicals and pathogens in the water, so thereby it would reduce the sulfur smell that comes out of the water. And this is a positive solution because it would only cost about $1,000 to $3,000 for each system that we add, and we could just add a couple along the whole length of the canal. And as opposed to dredging, which is taking out all of the sludge in the water with this huge crane, and the process takes over a year. And so this is what we've been doing in the past, dredging the canal of the sludge, and it's actually costed over $7.5 million. So it's a clear cost-efficient solution.
So one of the largest problems that we had to cover was the potential 100-year flood. And in order to do that, we took a look at the watershed and we noticed that it's a highly residential area, so there are a lot of roofs and a lot of surface area where rain potentially could be collected. So we thought that if the government was able to incentivize all of the residents of the Olawai watershed to get a, 50-gallon tank? A 50-gallon tank for their houses during when it rains, we could collect the water that falls on their roofs and store it in those tanks. And in this way, we could retain these large amounts of water so that they wouldn't flow down the stream and overpower Waikiki all at once. And then a few days after, when the rain has gone away and it's dried out, then the water could be released slowly and it could percolate down and hopefully travel back to our aquifer. So in that way, we would be reducing a great amount of water that would overpower Waikiki and the Olawai.
So we didn't want to limit our water catchment system to suburban areas because Waikiki is mainly urban. So we wanted to add sustainable green roofs to all the buildings. So you might have seen this, but it's not really common in Hawaii. But we could just add layers of soil and filters and then a final layer of grass and plants on the top of each building. And this would absorb the rainwater that falls in the square area of the buildings. but it would also naturally reduce the solar radiation and thereby like make Hawaii a lot cooler and improve the energy efficiency of the buildings.
So another idea that we had to help with the flood was the installation of plastic roads. Now this hasn't been made anywhere yet, but I think that Hawaii would be a great place to try and test this out. And so plastic roads are roads made out of plastic, and so we can turn the large amount of plastic that we have on this island into something beneficial like plastic roads. And in these plastic roads, you can store water in there for a certain amount of time, and that'll help to make sure that there isn't a huge flood when the flood does come. And plastic roads not only help with that, but they help to reduce the carbon footprint because you don't have to constantly keep on repairing it because it lasts about 3 times longer than asphalt roads do. And so that's another perk that plastic roads give. And it's hollow on the inside, and so you can put tubes and wires and anything that needs to go underground into these roads, and you can just hide it away from human sight. So it's really appealing to the eye.
So another action solution that we discovered was after the March 2011 tsunami and earthquakes in Japan, the water was obviously really contaminated, and a solution that a Japanese scientist discovered is that he can use microbes to clean the water. So this is a process known as bioremediation, which is utilizing microbes to remove and neutralize contaminated soil and groundwater. And so his creation was basically soil mixed with a solution of live cultures of bacteria that is actually good, as it would eat pathogens and harmful environmental bacteria. So that's what it claims to do. And it's supposed to be super, far less expensive than several other waste management solutions. And it's actually shown results in Japan, where the water was brown and covered in debris, but eventually over a several month period, the water actually cleared up, and then you could see the sand that was at the bottom of all these water bodies. So we actually, Circe and I actually have been testing this solution of bokashi balls for Hawaii and for Alawai water specifically. So we've been testing whether it would reduce the turbidity of the water and reduce sludge levels.
Unfortunately, we did not have the same results as they did in Japan, but we are giving a presentation about this very soon, and so, yeah, our results were very different from what happened in Japan.
So the way in which we wanted to engage the community was through a taro patch. And if you look at Waikiki, it's a huge tourist mecca, and they do their best to get tourists in touch with our Hawaiian culture. We have flamethrowers and stuff like that, but we don't really have a Waikiki taro patch where tourists could come and see like what Hawaiians used to eat and how they used to farm. I think this would be a very valuable cultural, eye-opening cultural thing for these tourists. So we propose that the golf course that's next to the Alawai, there are all these runs, but there's also this land that's not being used for golfing at all. And if we were to cut out those pieces of land that aren't in use, we could redistribute the golf course, I think they're called runs, I'm not sure, so that they are consolidated and there's a more efficient use of land. And this would leave another section next to the Alawai that could be used to plant taro and to bring the community in and get them engaged. This would also, in the event of a flood, stem the flood a little bit because Terra patches are lower land and they can like hold store water. And and our very last portion of our project was kind of a dream that we could organize all of these different businesses and ideas and community engagement places into one like facility that could house everything that has to do with the Alawai. So our dream was to tear down the old library that's at the end of the Alawai and rebuild it so that the bottom half would still be a public library, but the top could be a center for everything that has to do with the Alawai. So if people wanted to come and donate money to the cause, they would go there. If they wanted to rent fishing poles and get a space along the Alawai to fish out invasive species, they would come here. If they wanted to have their booth at the Alawai Promenade and sell their products, they would come to this center. So in this way, we could have a centralized unit or building that would be focused on the efforts of improving the Alawai.